Right, you don't realize something. All right, hello. Welcome.
Thank you for coming.
So my name's Nick Irwin, and I am going to talk about staying top of mind. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, if you can't, let me know. Just waiting on Zach to leave. I don't want to hear anything.
I watched the rain.
All right, so I've been in the business about 5 years, and I got my broker's license 2 years ago, and we formed the
East Bay in June.
About a year ago.
Do I really have to hold this thing this close?
Okay. We got a lot of security blankets going on here. So anyway, that's a little bit about us. I sold medical software before I started selling real estate, and the travel and not having a community of people around me really started to take a toll, and so I decided that I wanted to do something that was more Nashville-based, and I had always wanted to be a realtor. I know that's really odd, because this is a second or third or fourth career for most people, but it was kind of my dream, but my mom and dad told me that I needed to go to college and get a real job, and here we are. Anyway, so that's a little bit about me. And my first year in the business, you know, as a lot of people kind of don't know what to do to get business. So I did a combination of things that they teach us here. So open houses as much as possible, online leads, and that was a miserable experience. So if you've all been down that road, I don't recommend it, although it did help me get started and at least eliminate one source of business that I wasn't going to go after. So I ended that first year of the business with about 9 transactions. And then we're going to talk today about how I built things, systems in my business, processes that we use to stay top of mind. And hopefully this year will end the year around 40 transactions. So decent enough growth over 5 years for me anyway. It's not been... That's right. I'm just kidding. Tough crowd. All right. Woo! So after the first year, that whole thing with online leads, you know, it is a very specific business model. And the name of the game in that world is speed to lead, and you have to call people back immediately and run and jump and check properties. And I found it to be an exhausting way to live. Not only that, I don't really like strangers. I mean, I'm really uncomfortable up here in front of y'all, and I know most of you, so that's an indication. I really don't like to work with people that I don't know. So it was an uphill battle for me. And so about at the end of year one, I decided that I was going to focus just on the neighborhood that I lived in. And that area is McFerrin Park, which you've probably heard of by this point, but 5 years ago, nobody has really heard of it. So McFerrin Park, Cleveland Park, and Highland Heights, those are my people, that's where I focus. It's a neighborhood that is west of Ellington Parkway, east of Dickerson Road, and then everything south of Trinity Lane. So there's about 2,000 to 3,000 homes in that area, and I kind of focus, like I said, focus on that. So we'll jump through some of the things I did to target those people. I didn't start with that because I thought that I needed to try to be all things to all people, and you know, I think you'll find that if you pick a niche and sort of stick to that, that you'll be better served, or at least I have been. So this is a comprehensive list of the things that we do today to stay top of mind. So I know this may seem overwhelming to you. That's kind of the intent, right? With a lot of stuff. But this is 5 years in. So just know that you start small and you build to kind of a bigger list of things to do. And one of the things that I focused on at the beginning was this idea that I'm going to be in this business until I die, hopefully. So I wanted to create some plans of being able to scale things and maintain the ways of reaching out to people as my business grew.
A lot of the stuff is really easy to do when you are brand new because you have a lot of time. So when you're a new agent, and if you all are taking photos and all of that, that's great. But I have some handouts to give you. I'll give them to you at the end. So when you're a new agent, you've got a lot of time, right? So plenty of time to explore things, figure things out, write newsletters, write blog posts, all that stuff. As you become more seasoned, you get more money, hopefully, if you're doing it right, but you have a whole lot less time. So again, just that idea that think about the things that you start when you're new, make sure that you have a plan in place to continue doing those as you get more and more experience. So with that being said, who, this is the audience participation part, so here, right? Who's been in the business, just show up in less than 12 months? Okay. And then what about like 12 months to the 4 or 5 year range? Okay, anybody longer than 5 years? Okay, cool. That was for my own benefit to get an idea of the work of it. All right, so we talked a bit about sustainability, and this idea really was crystallized for me of having two different jobs. And I don't know if you've read this book that you have revisited, but it's fantastic that it explores this idea of, okay, I'm working in my business, so I'm actually servicing clients, finding clients, making money, and then I also have another full-time job that is building this business. And that's the kind of sustainability thing that we talked about. This is super hard. So a lot of people that come into this industry think that, you know, I want flexibility and I want my time back and I want my life back. And we were going through these slides this morning and kind of laughed about leaving a different career for a higher quality of life and more free time. And really, when you get here, you end up with very little of free time for me. So keep that in mind. But so if you haven't read this, like, I certainly recommend it, especially if you're early on, to kind of get the idea around, all right, so I've got to actually do the job and get proficient and hopefully really good at that piece of it. But then also building a business to where I can continue to do that job, process more clients, and do everything more efficiently and at a higher level. So there's a whole lot of stuff that's not about staying top of mind, but I felt like we should start there. So this is, that earlier list is broken down into some items that cost mostly time, some that are kind of time slash money, and then over on the far right-hand side, some of the things that cost a lot more time, a lot more money than time. So we're going to talk through these, and you know, if you've got any questions about any of these specific things that I do, I'm happy to dig into those. So thing one, again, when you're new, or even if you've been doing this for a while, organize your database. That's not a new idea, but it's certainly something that you should focus on. So, you know, who are these people? Get as much contact information as you can from them, and kind of how did they come to you? And then that's going to, of course, lay the groundwork for consistently being able to reach out to them. So at the end of every year, I look back at the previous year's transactions and source all of my business. I've now tried to do it kind of throughout the year, but this is a really good exercise, no matter how long you've been doing this, to evaluate where you're spending your money, where those clients are coming from, and kind of make some adjustments. So that's how I was able to axe the online leads thing. I spent a ton of money on that and getting, you know, relatively little business from that. And through that exercise, realized that, you know, more of my business was coming from my neighborhood, so I was able to sort of retool and focus on things, on those things. Lucky for me, that was a cheaper route too. So, some of these things that cost most of the time. So putting together a newsletter, phone calls to everyone in your database just to check in, hang out, you know, what are you doing, what's going on in your life. Door knocking, that one terrifies me, quite frankly. But I did do it early on in the neighborhood to sort of get my face out there and meet my neighbors. And it's very organic, or it was for me, because, you know, they were my neighbors. Like, I was walking the dog, and sometimes I would go and say hello to people. It's that sort of thing. Social media posts, all of this next to really free, right? Get involved with your community, talking problems in neighborhood homes. So some of the things that I do that are sort of money and time, handwritten notes in the mail. Any of you that have been through the ninja training may focus on that a lot. And also on gratitudes, which is kind of how Zach runs the sales meeting. And some of the things that Chris talked about this morning, like getting your mindset right early on, really, really important. And writing notes in the mail is still a way that I'm able to kind of reframe this and reach out to people. And just let them know that you're thinking about them, or that you saw that it's their birthday online, or I mean, whatever. Just reach out. Open houses, bottom-up videos, virtual assistants. Let me talk about that virtual assistant piece for a little bit. So, you know, about a year into this thing, I was really struggling with a lot of the things that I hated to do. So, like, I'm not good at putting together an online newsletter. I don't think that anything I have to say is important or that people care, right? I didn't realize that wasn't really the point. The point is to be in their inbox every month, have your name in the subject line, and you know, just get something out there to them. So again, I was struggling and spending way too much time building things like that. Once I got a little bit of money, I was able to hire a virtual assistant to compile a newsletter every month and then send that out to my database. So you don't have to do the things that you hate forever. Just like, get a plan in place more quickly for those that you don't like. And then the bomb-up videos thing, a good example of, are y'all familiar with what that is? Yes, it's a video service. They have a plugin for Gmail, click a button and it like videos you and it sends it to everybody. Okay. You can probably do the same thing with your iPhone without the interface, but anyway. A couple weeks ago in the sales meeting, Zach talked about the interest rates. It was on that graph earlier when they took a real big decline. And I looked back at my database and people that had bought 2 years ago or longer and sent out just a quick video email. I was sitting in the attic and said, hey, you know, interest rates are this. If you bought more than 2 years ago, it might be worth considering refinancing. You know, reach out to a lender. I tagged a couple of my lender partners in an email, reach out to them. And I got a really good response from that. Not direct business, but you know, certainly things like that to add value to your clients. Again, I am playing the long game here. I want to be in real estate for as long as I am alive, hopefully. And so I don't care if they buy something from me 30 days from now. I want their business, you know, in a year, at 5 years, and 10 years. So that's kind of my strategy with all of that. And then on the cost more money than time spectrum, these are some of the things that we've started doing in the last 2 years or so. Every Go Direct postcards, so I send out postcards to our database, happy hours, we do professional video shoots once a year. We have a couple of client events, and we're going to dig into a couple of those things in the next few slides.
Are y'all with me? Are you asleep?
Okay. More slides.
More slides. All right, so I'm on five, and I have five more. Halfway done. So, all right, so cost no money and just time. This is a screenshot of my website, and every month in that neighborhood that I talked about, I pull the statistics for real estate. So the number of homes that have sold, the average price per square foot, the amount of inventory, that kind of stuff. And there's a little screen grab of it over there. I write this really boring, dry, nerdy thing about the stats, and then they're down here for all of those people that don't want to read all of that stuff. So this is the most recent iteration of this. When we started out doing it, I would literally just create a graphic in Canva and throw it up on the neighborhood website, right? So just consistently putting stuff out there. So that evolved. So that's evolved into this blog post, and then also now I do a video, which I hate. Robin forces me every month. So I do a video, put that out there, and sometimes we put a little bit of ad spend behind it, but not ever very much. And again, I think I talked about the boundaries of the neighborhood earlier, but the reason that I chose that neighborhood, one, I live there, and so it's kind of easy for me to work there. But then also early on, that zip code that I live in is 37207, and it was sort of this forgotten stepchild of the East Nashville market. And so there's a real gap. If you look at the zip code map, it's like this big, and then it blows up into Bordeaux, like for that 37207 zip code kind of, and left, right? Am I wrong? All right. And then when you cross Ellington Parkway, it's the traditional East Nashville zip code of 37206. So I quickly realized that our values, the architecture, housing style, the setup of the neighborhood, our values were higher than the rest of the 07 zip code, but not quite as high and desirable as the 06 zip code. So there was a gap in the market there that I identified. And so I really tried to focus on capitalizing on that by continuously providing those housing values. This is our neighborhood yard sale. So I'm not by nature a yard sale lover. So this was fun for me. But what we do for this event, it's one of our bigger events of the year. It takes a lot of bandwidth for us to put together on the front end. But it costs relatively little money. So what I do, I'm involved in the three neighborhood associations that I already mentioned. I advertise that we're going to have a community yard sale on this particular date, and then I create a Google form where people can sign up. So they're going to give me their name and their phone number and their email address. So I'm list building with this, right? And once I get that, we then, you know, if they want to participate in the yard sale, the whole concept is they have a yard sale of their own house in their own yard. I just compile the information and generate these maps. So it's got just a list of all the people that want to participate in that yard sale, and then that over there is the backside of the handout. So property addresses and just general information about what they're going to be selling. All of this comes from that Google form. So again, my workload on this is creating the map. And then we hand out these maps. This year I did a little tent at my house with donuts and coffee, so people could come by and meet me and talk and have donuts and coffee and hang out and get maps. Also, we'll have a crop. Are y'all excited? So also there were 30 people that signed up this year to participate, and so we made these little gift bags and handed out to everyone. And inside of this bag, it has a yard sale sign, a packet of like 25 or 30 maps, some waters, and candy, and yard sale pricing stickers. So, a couple days before the yard sale actually happened, we drove around and delivered those to everybody, kind of met with some people. You know, we did it in the afternoon, so not a lot of people were home, but they were in a bag, so we were able to just hang it on the front door. I got a lot of credibility from that on the neighborhood Facebook groups. So people talking about, hey, thanks, this looks like it's so well organized, like it's put together, all that stuff. And you'll see, I mean, I've got my branding stuff, you know, here and here. And that's kind of it. So 30 people participated in having the actual yard sale at their house. I don't really have a good idea of how many people were in the neighborhood, but there's a lot of traffic from that. But the most important thing is I added people to my database. So this is the second year that we've done it. Now people are going to expect it year after year. We built a system around how to do it. So it's not easy, but easier than it was when we first started. And the grand total of the cost on something like this, I spent $98.25 on sign, stickers, candy. And then we put $40 behind a Facebook ad advertising it. And now I can't walk down the street without people being like, oh my gosh, your yard sale sale, thanks so much, blah, blah, blah. You can't tell, I really love that. So, again, just an idea. And then this is kind of on the more money end of the spectrum. I mentioned at the end of year one, I doubled down on this whole neighborhood idea and branding myself as the expert in the neighborhood. Part of my vision for that always was a postcard campaign. And I just didn't have the bandwidth to put that kind of thing together. So once I hired an assistant and had some help with that, we set out a plan to do this. So these are a couple of examples of those. Does everybody know what Every Door Direct is? Have you heard of this? So briefly and on a very basic level, it is you take some postcards to the post office and they deliver them to everyone in a mail carrier route. And the benefit of that is that you don't have to individually address them. There's some rules that's pretty clearly laid out on the post office website. So don't leave here and just start this kind of thing. This is something that, you know, when I started it, I wanted to make a commitment to do it for at least a year and then reevaluate whether it was working or not. This cost us about $500 a month, and we sent it to about 1,800 residents in the neighborhood. It's also really hard to quantify. Like, I can't track if a deal came from these postcards, but I know that I've got an established brand in the neighborhood. They see my face every month. They call me when they need to refinance, or you know, they have a family member that's looking to move to town, or they want to know how much equity they have in their house. So this was just a really good way for me to underscore that whole strategy. Again, it's something that probably don't want to jump into. So I'm good for that. All right, we're at slide number 8. Alright. So that was kind of a brief overview of a few of the things that we do. The next slide is just going to get back to that stay top of mind slide and pull in some of those things that we do and kind of answer any questions that you have. But we are always reevaluating all of the things that we do to see if they're a wise use of our money and if we need to continue those things, if they're driving business to us or not. So what things are y'all doing that I'm not doing? It's your turn. Robbie, did you raise your hand?
Oh.
I'm just kidding.
No, but working in the same office as Nick, it's kind of amazing to see everything that he does and how consistent he is with it. I think that's my biggest takeaway from sitting beside him in these categories. Like, he comes in, he has an agenda, he has a goal, and he sticks to the plan. We operate very differently, and I'm very organic and don't have a ton of structure. I've got great systems in place because I do like efficiency. But I've learned a lot about being intentional with my marketing and being intentional with the things that I do and making sure that not only that I'm doing them, but they make sense and that I track what I'm doing and if it works. I think that's a huge strength of Nick's and something that is a takeaway that you should all have is don't just do stuff. Do stuff with intention, and also even the best intention stuff sometimes doesn't work, and you've got to pivot and find a better thing that does work. And the only way you're going to know if it doesn't work is if you're keeping track of where your business is coming from and making sure you kind of constantly evaluate what you said, which I've seen him do regularly.
Thanks for that. I didn't mean to. Thanks for the compliments.
I hate talking to you.
Right, I know you love it. So, sorry to make you nervous, but like you, what you said earlier today about controlling your mindset and like ravenously consuming information that's out there, like, that's so important, especially when you're first getting started. But I mean, I think even now, like, you know, whatever. That was good. Thank you. All right, what else? Anybody doing stuff that they want to? I want to hear your ideas of things that I could be doing better. No, that's not what this is.
I have a question.
Tyler Graham.
So you evaluate all these things that you do. How often? Yearly?
Definitely yearly. It depends on the project, really. So like our goal this year was more signups for the art sale than we had last year, and then just spend less money than we did last year, and to try to not exhaust ourselves. And we had some of those goals.
So for example, like the postcards, so you evaluate those, but you don't know if they brought you direct business. So how do you evaluate those?
That's a real So that one project specifically is, it grates my nerves because I can't quantify the business that comes to me from it. And I knew that it would be that way going into it, and that's why I didn't want to just do it for a month. About 3 months in, I was at Folk having a drink at the bar, and somebody came up to me, it wasn't Chris, somebody was like, oh my gosh, you're Nick, you're the nerd, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, oh, okay, this is like working, you know? And so little things like that. I get phone calls all the time from people in the neighborhood that I have never met before, that just, it's because of all of this consistent writing. So I know that wasn't an answer to your question, but it's sort of a...
Well, there's a lot of agents that they get, especially when they first get in the business, and they feel like they have to spend a lot of money, which is not necessarily the case. So when did you say when you started doing the postcards in your business?
So,
and when would you recommend someone start spending money? Like that much money?
I didn't start it until year three. So we're about a year, 18 months or so into that. I wouldn't recommend you probably going in here do that right out of the gate. Another thing for me, like, it was part of my strategy, so I had a really well-defined audience. So I don't know if y'all remember, Village used to send out just listed and just sold cards with every listing, and they would do it to just a random smattering of people around the address. I don't think that's a good strategy. Like, I think it's kind of a waste of money. So, you know, if you've got some people and you've got the funds to continue to do it for a good 12 months, then I think that's the time to start. Also, we have the cost of that. We've worked really hard to control the cost. So at the beginning, you know, we're paying a little bit more for that. We sourced a new printer and kind of tightened up some of our processes. So early on, we would do everywhere direct stuff manually, and we can print out all this complicated, stupid process. You can print out all these like, forms and like bundle all the note cards and whatever. So we found Alphagraphics over on Main Street. And they have a service where they do all of that for you. So we literally just design the card every month, send it to them with the mail carrier routes, and then they send us the price, and then we pay them, they take care of all of it. So.
I'm interested on your portrait event.
Yeah.
Does that cost me how much, or?
I do not have a cost. Can I talk about what it is while
Robin how do you arrange all of that?
Yeah, so last year was the first year that we did it. Sam, Robbie, and I combined efforts, and we took over the East office one day in October. We were going to hire a photographer, but Robbie's really good at that, so he stepped up and did all the photos. Sam has a staging company, Public Region. I don't know if you use it, but you should. And so they came in and staged like two different scenes, and we just again sent out an email to all of our client database, had them sign up in different time slots, and then we all pitched in and made cookies and cider and that kind of thing. So it's like this fun hangout all day event. And so our clients would come, they would take pictures, and then leave. So there were like 15-minute time slots, I think. They brought their animals, so it was fun and a little bit chaotic at times. But then we sent those photos out to a professional to do some touch-up stuff, and then emailed them out to them. And we tried to do that in enough time that they could use it for their poly cards. Cost on that? $300? Okay, so around there.
For
all three of us.
For all three.
Yeah. So, I mean.
That's not.
Right.
This year will be different.
Robbie's not able to do it this year. It's too much. Right. He was exhausted before Robbie.
I was on there. But it was.
And most of my clients ended up liking him more than me. And so I'm like, all right. So that was my fear too, but guess what? It doesn't matter because the sunk cost of a photographer, you're going to spend the money whether people show up or not, right? So reframe your thinking and think about all of the touches that you can get out of it, out of one of them. So the yard sale, for example, we started 2 months before the event and emailed and posted in the Facebook group, and we did one of our postcards that kind of told people about it. And then when people sign up, you're reminding them that it's coming. You're reminding them that you're sending out a bag. You're reminding the whole neighborhood that the thing is happening. And kind of the same thing for the corporate events. Like, it's more about using these things as tools to get your name in front of people and let them know that you exist. Is that helpful?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did
this year when we do it, we're going to take a friend's photo. It's like, I didn't invite you guys, but so they truly enjoy it, want to be a part of it. It's way more fun. I had another friend, they brought their family. My voice is weird. But she said that it was the easiest family photo that they've ever taken. And she absolutely loved it. They were in and out, you know, 30 minutes, the kids were great. And, you know, as opposed to them getting all dressed up and going to some professional whatever, and there's strangers there, so. This is your event, it'll be fun, but people want to come, so.
And we, since the three of us did this event together, like, it kind of, you know, it was fun for our clients to get to meet other people on the team, and then to the point of being scared nobody's going to show up. Well, we kind of like each other, so we just hung out, you know?
Yeah.
You kind of like each other.
Yeah, so, are y'all familiar with what Dining Out for Life is? So, yes and no. So it's a charity for National Cares, and in April every year, restaurants all around the city participate, and they have these like community member hosts, and you go to a restaurant that they assign you to, you sort of reach out to your network and have people come to that restaurant and eat, and they donate a portion of those proceeds back to, a portion of their dinner tab for that night back to National Cares. So this is something that Melissa Lunder, who used to be an agent here, she was at Marche and hosted there forever and ever. And so she let me partner with her on that, and then she's moved to Palm Springs, but I've kind of continued that on. Again, lots of advertising, they're reaching out to the database to let people know it's coming. And that doesn't have to be as time consuming as what it sounds like. I mean, it could be Facebook posts and emails from MailChimp. That answer your question, Charles.
What is a natural real producer?
So, natural real producers is that magazine that we all get, I think. They're usually later on in the office. There's a group that started that. It's really just an industry magazine. And so they asked, several of you in the room have been in this, but they did a profile thing on me a year or so ago. And so they offer for you to be able to buy just like your photo and the copy. And so I did that, and I'm going to mail those out to everybody in the neighborhood, or not everybody in the neighborhood, but a curated list of folks. So again, just...
Not the one time, but...
It is, yeah.
What does the Blackstone Council pay?
Oh, that was a fun thing that kind of fell in my lap. So our District 5 council race was a bit contentious. We had three people who were running for the one seat. And so we, being involved in the neighborhood association, we had historically put on a debate with the three candidates. And so the attendance for that isn't always that great. And it's because it's at like 5:30, it's at the police precinct, so some people are hung up about, you know, going and sitting at the police precinct. And so I got this idea to live stream it in the Facebook group. So I hired a guy that came and did all the video setup, and he posted it, you know, under my name, and I just had my information down at the bottom of the screen, and it was an hour and a half, 2 hours long. And so many people were like, thanks so much, and I looked at it. I wasn't able to make it, but I really wanted to get the information, and so that's something that we did. I can't remember the cost on that. $500 was? $300? Less than that? Four. Robin says four. $400. But to be in front of somebody for, you know, an hour and a half or 2 hours, and it has quite a shelf life, right? So it lives out there for, you know, until the election happens. Robin said.
I know with certain things, when you're just starting out and doing things and not seeing immediate return, it can get frustrating, and that was kind of the case with a lot of like social media marketing. That's what I love and what I do, and people were like, well, are you getting business? And it didn't happen for a long time. Can you speak to that with some of these things about just time frames of, you know, what people could expect potentially? To, I think it was helpful for me to be like, yeah, it was great, it's the same thing. That like it takes a while, like it takes some time to keep at it, and eventually you'll see the return. What is your experience with
that? I mean, that time frame is hard to predict. This business sucks for a long time until it doesn't suck. It just does. It's hard. It's grueling. You get people at the worst point in their life, and they yell at you. I mean, that's still happens. Sometimes you actually don't have caffeine 5 minutes before another one. Maybe last week. I mean, really, like, it's not. I don't know. I mean, you just have to keep going and keep doing things. And I mean, a lot of this stuff is almost free. I mean, birthday cards, like, you know, come on. You can send stuff to people for their birthday. Another thing that's really easy, I don't know if it's on this list or not, but sending out the Hub 1 form at the end of the year. So, you know, I've heard this idea over and over again. So what we do is we pull those out and, you know, at the closing, put them in an envelope and send them out to them at the end of the year or in January because they need it for taxes. So yeah, just so they always think that I'm thinking of them. And now that Connie's gone, I can talk about this, but stay top of mind with your vendor partners too. So reach out to those people. I know, especially when you're new, like you got a ton of vendors like trying to knock your door down and take you coffee, like maybe take some of them up on it and then ask them for their money. Like, and if you do a deal or two together, like start leaning on them to help you with some of these costs. Charles?
I said, I found with that, getting with people who are a little bit older in the industry who aren't established was kind of difficult. So I just kind of started, I'm new myself, so I started looking and partnering with other people who, like newer lenders who have only been working for a couple months, just to try and build together with somebody as opposed to trying to get it with somebody who's established or already has those contacts.
I think that's a great tip. And if y'all didn't hear him on TV, partner with people that are at the same stage of their business as you are. So newer lenders, you're able to build your business with those people in a way that is really organic. And it just feels good to be referring business back and forth to other people. And then when you do a couple of deals together, you ask them for money and ask them to help you pay for things.
How do you do that?
You say, hey, I sent you three deals. You sent me nothing. So what we're going to do is you're going to pay me how much? What's your budget for helping me? And if they don't, then there's a million lenders out there. Like, find another one that's willing to help you. I mean, sorry. And then that's going to make money. I'm sorry?
When you start talking to lenders like that, the best thing to do is to have some sort of marketing strategy to one of them. And say, listen, I'm glad you called me because we're going out to coffee, but I wanted to talk to you about, I'm going to send out all these postcards, and it costs $600, and I would love it if you had your name and face on there and paid $300.
So,
give them a real number. They already have, you already have something set up that you want them to contribute to.
Yeah. And I mean, interview them like they're interviewing you too. You know, hey, I've got three people I work with. I like you the best. I'm giving you this opportunity first. And if you don't want it, then I'm going to offer it to the next people. Like, I'm still happy to work with you, but you know. And again, to Charles's point about people that are newer in their business, like lenders or whatever, I've benefited from those partnerships and the coaches that they hire. So I don't have to spend, I mean, I have done that before, but I don't have to spend my money to leverage some of the things that they're learning from their industry about marketing and events and different ideas like that. So, I know that. All three of you.
Just kind of go back to Robbie's point about how long to do something. How do you keep track of what you're doing on the marketing side as, like, you know, I mean, is it just as simple as like a spreadsheet? So you can just kind of quantify the data that you're able to?
Yeah, it is a spreadsheet. We try to get a general cost around each of those events, and I try to just see how many deals came from that, and then mentally decide, okay, was this a bust or not? Or how can we change it to make it better?
Oh, I was just going to say one thing I do. I certainly don't mail things out every month, like hard mail, but I do send a newsletter out every month. But then quarterly, I try to send something to my clients. You know, you can do something around holidays or New Year. In the spring, they get a pack of seeds, you know, to throw in their garden. In the fall, you know, they do pumpkin pies or mums to send to them.
So that was
I'm trying to send quarterly.
So do you deliver things to...
You know, I'm rethinking that this year. I did deliver mums last year. I delivered them. And I know some people have their clients come to the office and pick up pies or whatever. I haven't decided what I'm
doing. I love the idea of that. And I love the way it feels to be able to deliver that to someone. But, you know, year one.
Really far away.
Yeah, and year one, too, that's probably an attainable goal. But, you know, you start getting it.
I actually don't know what I'm going to do this month.
Yeah, I'm interested.
But I want to do something for them all.
Yeah.
And then I use Canva to create cards.
Sure.
I create custom birthday cards for people and print them here on the printer. And
yeah.
And then if you, you know, they'll all print cards for you. That is fairly useful right there. So. Yeah.
Early on, I try to trap people and make them give me reviews. I'm going back to that method. But, you know, I hired a videographer and went and like interviewed people in their house to do some video reviews early on. You know, put some ad money behind that. But really now we ask them, we send the Zillow link to them, and I want them to review me on Zillow. And we send that, you know, mid-transaction, I think, and then after the transaction also.
And so you're using Zillow?
Yes. I know that's a big bad word in here, but here's my logic behind that. The consumers are on Zillow, so they're going to look you up there. So I want to have a lot of reviews there. And we've got a really good response rate. But you also have to be careful. If you piss somebody off, don't send them a review. Communication down.
I think a good thing for me is just that making it as easy as possible for them. I send them actually three. I send them Zillow, Google, and Facebook. I send them all three links to my pages there. So that and I say copy and paste the exact same review on each of these. And they do most of the time. So then you're hitting multiple areas, but they, because a lot of times they, unless you tell them, like, hey, it's okay to copy and paste the same review, they're like, I'm not going to do a different one. I don't make the same thing. And they just need to be given permission to do that, but also easy access to their sites so that it's quick, fast, and it's out.
I also heard this at a couple of different conferences, but lay the groundwork for asking for the review at the very beginning. In my buyer meeting, I talk to them and say, hey, look, you know, I'm going to ask you for a review at some point, and I want you to give it to me, and I want it to be good. So if at any point I'm doing something that you don't think is good, then let me know, and I'll try to fix it. If not, then you can fire me, or I can fire you.
Also speaking to reviews, they sometimes maybe don't know what to say, so I know that we include just questions, like, hey, here's some questions you can answer in your review about me and your experience, to kind of help prompt them to say what you want them to say without telling them what to say.
Yeah, that's a good point. One thing we're doing, I'm getting ready to work on a plan for getting video reviews at closing. You know, there's that awkward time, right, where you get there and you're just like, so happy, but not really, like, whatever. And you're just sitting around the table, like, waiting on your turn to get everything together. So I'm going to have some cards with questions and video your answers right there in front of me. I haven't done it yet. We'll see how it works out. What do we do with that information, right? So the Zillow reviews, we take the copy from that, put it on our colors and our background, and then put it out into the universe. So we put it out on our Facebook, and sometimes, you know, do that once a week or two or whatever. Yes?
Let's talk about when you got a virtual assistant and where you felt that shift happen. Like when you thought, okay, like if I want to scale my business or if I want to be happier, like at what point was that?
That's a hard thing to answer. So I hired a virtual assistant probably 6 months in because I kept hearing Bobby Noreen talk about sending out a monthly newsletter, and I just couldn't do it, and I would beat myself up about it. And I wasn't good at it. Like, Ronnie Stone, if y'all are on his mailing list, he's fantastic. Personable, he has something to say. I don't want to talk to him. Like, I don't really care that much. Like, you know, so I just got somebody to compile information, you know, and then they would send it to me, and I would send it out. And that was like $30 a month, I think I paid for it. And that's also something that is scalable. So that grew into that person doing more things for me. And then kind of in the same line of conversation, like if you're not using a transaction coordinator or Village Assist, like you need to think about growing into that. And teaching yourself to let go of a lot of stuff and then to be able to delegate the things that you don't want to do or you don't have time to do.
And Village has that newsletter now.
Yeah, I mean,
brilliant.
I mean, yeah, you don't even need that. Just use Village. Because again, the point is like just get your name in front of them every month. It's not that you're like some real estate guru that's going to change their life. You know, they don't care. They're probably not going to read it. I hope they don't read mine. Although I've changed that a little bit, now we do like client spotlights, so that's fun because they get to see themselves, and then you know, if we do like a, an event or whatever, we'll put the photos from that in the newsletter. So it's like, it's grown into something that kind of like.
Was that process of having the virtual assistant create that, was that fairly user-friendly?
Sure.
Pretty painless process?
Yeah. So I sat down one day and made a list of all of the news sources of stuff in Nashville that I read. So like Nashville Eater about the restaurants and like the city scene or what, that's not even around anymore, but it was, I promise. So I sent them a list of links where I got stuff from, and then they would just compile a newsletter. I gave them my login and password for MailChimp, and they would build it for me in MailChimp, and then I would just literally send it out. And our process now is not that different. I mean, Robin knows that, but it's kind of a similar process.
Yes. Your social media, do you push everything out through your Instagram and your Facebook equally? Like in my professional business, I feel like I reach different clients through Facebook and Instagram. So how do you feel about that? Because it sounds like you do most of your things through Facebook.
Most of it is through Facebook. I try to run my own Instagram stuff and just post pictures of my dog and then houses every now and then. I'm really inconsistent with it. If I get a listing or something, I might, if I'm having a day where I'm thinking about it, then I'll create a story. But, you know, I'm so mindful about that all. I oscillate between wanting to hide in a cave and then wanting to tell everybody everything that's wrong. So, this is a struggle. But no, to answer your question, I wouldn't recommend putting the same things on both.
For each home that you sell, you do three things on social media. Like you were telling me this a couple weeks ago. Picture with clients. Can you remind me of what else?
So I try and get like a photo of the house, a photo of the client, and think about like using these houses, the listings and or the clients for as much mileage as you can on your social media. So, you know, if you use a picture of the inside of the house once it goes under contract, then you can use a picture of the outside of the house when it's sold and maybe something else when it's just listed, right? So you get three posts out of that, and then a picture of the people that bought it or sold it. So that's four posts out of the one thing. So it makes people in your universe think, gosh, she's really killing it. I'm like, man, I just sold one house this thing. Yeah? All right, I have anything else? And then I'm done. Unless y'all have any more questions.
Thank you.